Secretary Teodoro, just yesterday, the Department of Foreign Affairs announced that the Philippines and China have already reached an agreement with regard to the Ayungan Shoal. How will rotation and resupply missions now be carried out under this new agreement?
We'll have to wait for the National Maritime Council to convene and for the DFA to relate to us what exactly has been agreed upon. I don't have any information at this time, so it would be premature for me to comment.
Right. I understand that information, details of that meeting have not yet been relayed. But the Philippines earlier called China out for their actions in the West Philippine Sea, saying that the Philippines will neither seek permission nor consent from anyone, nor will it publish any schedule of RORA missions. What was the directive of President Marcos to the DFA, or at least to the panel, before going into this meeting? Do we have at least any guarantee that these conditions were not compromised?
I'm certain that the DFA is conscious of those parameters that it cannot exceed, and I have no reason to doubt that such parameters were not heeded in coming into this arrangement or agreement with China.
Right. Secretary Teodoro, we understand that China and the Philippines have also agreed to establish a new presidential hotline, which can be used in case of any confrontations in the West Philippine Sea. What makes this different from the hotline that President Marcos Jr. and President Xi Jinping agreed upon in January last year?
Well, that remains to be seen. I cannot say with certainty what the difference will be. However, given the fact that there have been bilateral committee meetings on de-escalation, I mean, probably this is another venue where things can be settled without having to let things spread further that can lead to an armed conflict.
Right. Secretary Teodoro, what keeps you optimistic that China will do good on what was agreed upon this time around? Because frankly speaking, Beijing does not have a good track record of following what was agreed upon, whether verbally or on paper.
Well, definitely. That's why my focus really is on deterrence and on speedily building up a credible deterrent force, not only in terms of capabilities, but also in terms of systems and skill sets. And that goes not only for the armed forces of the Philippines, but principally in my own department, the Department of National Defense, where what we want to see is for Congress to fast track the enactment of a DND transformation bill, copies of which I have given to both the Senate President and the Speaker of the House and the leaderships of both chambers, so that we can provide the proper managerial and strategic support to all the agencies that fall under us. The DND as a department is one of the smallest in terms of manpower and in terms of resources, considering what it has to manage. And I think that we have to level up from the department down to its five agencies so that if we can manage the introduction of the deterrent capabilities and to implement the CADC and other measures to counter disruptive and information operations against the Republic of the Philippines sustainably and professionally and competently.
Okay, Secretary, I'm glad that you mentioned the information operations being done against the Philippines. Just last week, the DND, your department, was front and center of a controversy with some bloggers and commentators alleging that there was a walkout during a command conference. Can you tell us more about that incident?
That has been denied several times. There was no such incident as far as I'm concerned. And now let's put it just to settle matters. It is a principle of fairness that he or she who alleges proves. So let them prove it.
We understand, Secretary Teodoro, that last week the AFP spokesperson mentioned to Head Start that the AFP is looking into whether or not there were legal violations linked to that issue. Will the DND or will any agency under your department actually file cases against those who peddled this fake news?
That matter has to be investigated. We need to get to the source of these rumors and find out what we can do about it. And we feel that not only these rumors, but there are a lot of misinformation going around. So we appeal to the public. Nakikiusap kami sa ating mga kababayan na maging masusi sa pag-aaral ng impormasyon kung ano ang kumakalat dyan sa media. Kasi madami ngayon ng chismis, no? There's a lot of disinformation and misinformation going around. And a lot of this is seeks to distract us from ensuring that we get a credible defense posture. It's trying to weaken our political, economic, and social fabric.
All right. Before we talk about the solutions that the DND presents to that problem, talk to us first about how wary the department and the administration is when it comes to these attacks on another front. How grave is the problem of misinformation operations against the Philippines?
We don't take these things lightly because of the freedom of information and freedom of the press and the basic freedoms of speech that we have in this country. It is something that we have to deal with. Unlike other countries with closed systems, like China, for example, they don't need to deal with this. They just shut you down or put you to jail. Well, with us, we have to deal with a free marketplace of ideas, and it is a fine line that separates free speech from a possible offense or violation.
And how is the DND addressing this problem? Is the agency at least flexing some efforts to track down who are behind these propagandas?
We are leaving it to the appropriate intelligence agencies to do so. We are working with the DICT. Because the DND is not an investigative agency, so we leave it to, we have a Defense Intelligence and Security Group here. We leave it to them to ferret out the source of these rumors. And then after it has been established with credible evidence as to who the perpetrators of these rumors are, we find out what we can do about it.
Aside from this rumor mongering, are there any other reports as to what Beijing or any actors are doing to somehow distract us, again, in your own words, from getting a solid defense posture in the West Philippine Sea?
The most prevalent is the assertion that any attempt of the Philippines to upgrade its capabilities in order to enter into functional and working alliances with like-minded nations is deemed by China as a provocation. And for example, we heard rumors that there are targets in this country because of supposed capabilities that the U.S. government has here. This is a consistent narrative by China. And for example, too, to counter this, what we should see is that the G7 came out against the acts of China in the West Philippine Sea, a host of other countries, the EU, and each and every time China has retorted that these statements disturb regional peace. So China's rhetoric is that they are the only ones correct and everybody else is wrong. Well, I think they should examine very closely the real state of things. If a lot of people in the world are saying there's something wrong with you, then it's high time that you self-examine.
And Secretary, what about talk of sleeper agents coming here in the Philippines? With the case of Bamban Mayor Alice Guo, there have been a lot of rumors about China actually seeding some of their agents here, posing either as students or as tourists, as businessmen. What do you say about those?
That is something that we have to be on guard against. Although naming somebody as a sleeper agent or somebody as an agent of a foreign power demands a modicum of evidence. What we have here is evidence very clearly of syndicated cyber crimes and other heinous crimes like human trafficking perpetrated by non-Filipinos and allowed to operate in our environment. And this is heavily on the domestic agenda of a lot of government agencies to stop, because it is a way of weakening our political and economic fabric. And it is also undeniably a way where foreign agents can co-opt the Philippines. That is why we are also appealing to Congress to amend the law against espionage to make it effective even in times of peace, not only in times of war. Another law is that we would like military jurisdiction to be returned to general courts martial so that we can properly deal with malfeasance, misfeasance, and nonfeasance of armed forces personnel. They are now, these offenses are now relegated to civilian courts where we cannot hold these personnel and we cannot account for them after they are separated from the service. We can only charge them with conduct unbecoming an officer or an enlisted personnel. So a lot of these legislative measures are necessary, particularly the law against espionage, because it is only applicable during times of war.
All right. Aside, Secretary, aside from the fact that it is only applicable during the times of war, when there is already a declaration of war, what other provisions in the espionage law do you hope that Congress, or would you recommend for Congress to amend to make it more effective against the Philippines' current plight?
Well, a lot of new offenses like cyber crimes and other ways of sharing information should be included in the law, because you know, mere face-to-face confrontations are not the way things are done. Electronic exchanges of information and other innovative and disruptive ways of doing harm to the Philippines are necessary. And I think there's also a proposal to register a person as a foreign agent to legitimize the efforts of that foreign agent in dealing with government agencies, such as we have in other countries, so that the bona fides of this person seeking registration as a registered foreign agent of a foreign government, rather, can be established by the intelligence agencies.
Right. Secretary Teodoro, since you already mentioned cyber crimes, what is the Philippines actually doing to ensure that it is adequately protected against cyber attacks? Because last week, we just saw the shutdown of multiple companies, airlines, airports, travel, just because of a cyber case. The Philippines also saw several of its agencies being shut down by hackers. What is the Philippines now doing to ensure that will not happen again in the coming months?
Well, of course, we collaborate on redundancy and securing our information bases. In the armed forces of the Philippines, they are developing their information and cyber networks on a redundant basis, also with the DND. We need to do this in order to be able to engage with our counterparts on a one-to-one basis. Right now, we are restricted from engaging, whether it be capabilities, whether it be information exchange with our counterparts, because of we have not passed their cyber and information technology and other operational security vetting. It does not only include information communications technology and cyber, but it also includes our operational security protocols, document handling, classifications, and the like. So we need to harden our information systems. We need to improve our connectivity. This is a hard thing to do. And we need to build redundancy and siloing of information in order to mitigate the effects of a possible breach.
All right, Secretary, let's now move on to another defense-related topic, which is the reciprocal access agreement with Japan. A few weeks ago, the President, the Philippines and Japan just signed that agreement into law. Where are we now in the process of operationalizing the RAA?
We hope that the Senate ratifies or gives its concurrence to the treaty as soon as possible so that we can lay down the implementing rules and regulations that will put it into place. We look forward to Japan's soonest participation in not only multilateral exercises, but developing our own bespoke bilateral exercises. As you know, this will be a fitting complement to Japan's support for the Philippines' defense posture. We were the first recipients of official security assistance from Japan. Japan is a preferred partner in our capability upgrades, and we look forward to developing confidence with the Japanese Self-Defense Force. There is already trust. We now have to build to engage in confidence building measures in terms of interoperability between the armed forces and the Japan Self-Defense Force.
Right. Secretary Teodoro, I understand that the Senate has yet to ratify this agreement, but offhand, while the legislative department is working on that, I understand that the DND and other government agencies are already drafting an IRR. What will be the salient points of this IRR?
Well, the salient points will be what kind of what the mechanisms are for developing the annual activities per year, what the communications flow will be, what the authorities for approving certain types of activities are, and of course, after that, it will be what the administrative setups for executing the RAA will be.
Right. Secretary Teodoro, how will this actually, the RAA, how will it actually affect the way that the Philippines conducts its rotation and resupply missions in the West Philippine Sea, as well as safeguarding our exclusive economic zone? Because frankly speaking, one of the often mentioned criticisms against the Philippines VFA with the United States is that it cannot be enforced at a time of need when Chinese ships and maritime militia vessels are already sort of attacking, not the attack like involving weapons, but they are already putting in danger several Filipinos who are there operating in our own exclusive economic zone. So again, how will this RAA make our current situation different against the aggressive actions of China in the West Philippine Sea?
Thank you for asking that question, because the public is always focused on retaliation, no? And for the US MDT, that is Article 4 of the MDT. But we do practice Article 1, Article 2 and 3. That means consultation and capability enhancements. So the RAA with Japan will be a fitting complement to, in order for the armed forces to get another dimension in order to improve its capabilities. Now, The issue of the resupply, the government by policy chooses to make this a totally Filipino endeavor. And we want to build up our capabilities in order to ensure a regular and routine resupply. More than that, though, we want to build up our deterrent capabilities as soon as possible, because deterrence is the best defense.
Speaking of deterrence, I understand that Japan has sold several Coast Guard ships to the Philippines. It has also given some radars to the Philippines as well. But when push comes to shove in the West Philippine Sea, in the next few weeks, in the next few months, we know how volatile the situation is there. What can Japan and the U.S. and our other allies offer that will make Filipinos easily see that these agreements are not just something on paper?
Well, naturally, when push comes to shove, I have no doubt that these allies will come to our aid. However, it is incumbent upon all responsible officials to deconflict and to deter these unthinkable events from happening. However, when push comes to shove, naturally, I do not have a doubt that our allies will come to our assistance.
Mm-hmm. Secretary Teodoro, with the expected ratification of the Reciprocal Access Agreement, we are again expecting China to be again angered and issue statements against the Philippines, trying to rally the global community against Beijing. How will the Philippines actually juggle that situation, considering that we already have a new agreement with China when it comes to raw emissions in the Ayungan Shoal?
I don't think there's anything to juggle insofar as agreements with the like-minded nations are concerned. And I think the RAA with Japan will not be the last RAA because we are working on RAAs with several other like-minded nations as well. So it is up to China the whole cause of the problem in the West Philippine Sea is the nine dash line of China and nothing else. So it is really up to them to react, while we cannot be deterred from doing what we need to do in order to build up our credible defense posture, which includes our alliances with like-minded nations for the upholding of a rules-based international order.
Secretary, go ahead, sir. Sorry for interrupting you.
No, go ahead.
I was just quite excited to hear that the Philippines is working on other reciprocal access agreements with other like-minded nations. Care to say what nations we are talking about?
Well, we are going to work with on an RAA, hopefully with Canada, with France, as my counterpart Minister Lecornu and I announced last year, with New Zealand and with other countries that escaped my memory at this time.
So we are talking about at least three first world countries here. Any timeline? Yes. So far, when do we expect the RAAs between the Philippines and these other countries to come out?
Hopefully by next year. It is not easy to negotiate the RAA, and that's why also we want a defense transformation bill to come out, because our staff is limited and they've been working more than others. Can you imagine, with only 267 employees in this department, negotiating an RAA and finishing it in 6 months, that is a big accomplishment. And I'm very proud of what everybody is doing in this department, despite its handicap. So I hope our legislators listen and capacitate us so we can do more.
Right. Very quickly, Secretary Teodoro, let's talk about the RAAs of these at least three countries. What will the RAA between Canada and the Philippines be like?
It will also involve interoperability. They will all look the same. They will allow armed forces of these different countries to operate with the Philippine armed forces within the Philippine territorial jurisdictions, and vice versa. So it will increase interoperability between these countries. And an RAA basically is not the culmination, it is close to the apex of a defensive alliance, but not at the top. A mutual defense treaty is, but an RAA is close to that.
Secretary Teodoro, I'm just curious how political movements in certain countries would affect its RAA negotiations with the Philippines, particularly in France. We do know that they recently held polls, and President Emmanuel Macron just lost the majority of his support, at least from the parliamentary. Do we have a guarantee that France is still committed to create an RAA with the Philippines despite leadership or possible leadership changes in its country?
I believe so, because despite the political changes, the interests remain the same. France would like to work in order to uphold the rule of international law. It has presence in the Pacific area. So the Indo-Pacific stability and security is very important to it. So in spite of changes in the political makeup of these countries, whether they be in the Western or the Eastern Hemisphere, European or whatnot, I think the interests remain the same. And we also are looking at closer relationships with the United Kingdom, who has expressed a lot of interest in working closer with us.
All right. Secretary Teodoro, this afternoon, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. will be delivering his third State of the Nation address. How has the Philippine defense sector improved in the past years? And what achievements of your sector do you expect the president to highlight in his speech?
Well, in internal security, we are now down. Instead of the normal fronts that are the basis of accomplishments, we are now down to actual names. Even though the internal security threat has been minimized, it does not disappear. And we are also looking very closely at internal subversion that is motivated by foreign powers. Secondly, in international engagements, we have had enhanced cooperation not only with the United States. We have secured additional skills and capabilities from them. And after we pass security vetting, we will be able in several ways, not only through perhaps grants, get a lot more capabilities. With Japan, we have signed the RAA, and with like-minded nations, a lot has happened. He has approved our Re-Horizon 3, and we understand the fiscal space of government is tight. Therefore, the obligation to secure financing is on my shoulders, and I'm working very hard in order to secure appropriate financing that is affordable and will not be a big burden to the Filipino people through creative financing measures. We also are very busy interconnecting and making connectivities in between and amongst the different systems that we have been acquired before, to make a lot of our systems workable. We also are embarking on a strategic basing program in order to institute the game-changing CADC Comprehensive Archipelagic Defense Concept under the Marcos administration that has been introduced in order to project our deterrent capabilities within our exclusive economic zone and other areas where we have jurisdiction. In disaster risk reduction, we have an increased budget for the NDRIM fund for next year, realizing that there could be a La Nina until the first quarter of next year, and a lot of rehabilitation of vital infrastructure has to be done. Thirdly, disaster risk reduction, a lot of major infrastructure that the president has embarked on and connectivities have impacts on disaster risk reduction. For example, the Metro Manila Flood Control Project, which is Metro Manila-wise, wide rather, has a lot of mitigating impacts on flooding in Metro Manila, which directly impacts the disaster resilience of our country, which is really important for national defense. So these are a few of the achievements of the Marcos administration for the last year.
All right, Secretary Teodoro, finally, a lot of sectors are hoping that the president will finally make public his stance on Philippine offshore gaming operations during his third SONA. He has been quite silent on this issue despite a lot of developments already. Should we expect the president to already declare or heed calls to declare POGOs as a national security threat?
I think the proverbial POGO is a national security threat. However, legitimate business process outsourcing firms that have been operating without taking and paying out bets from within our shores should be allowed to continue because of the employment it gives Filipinos. It is these POGOs, which are criminal syndicates, that should and are unregulated, by the way. A lot of them are unregulated. That is why it is an intelligence challenge for the various intelligence agencies to discover where these illegal hubs operate from. That should be stopped.
All right, we will have to wait and see if the president will mention that issue in his SONA later. Thank you so much for making time for us during this busy morning. Defense Secretary Gibo Teodoro, see you later at the Batasang Pambansa.
Thank you, Katrina.